young scholars and researchers to take a lead and execute these ideas.
We groom our own people. We groom our own talent. That we just don't go about acquiring talent, but we also get a chance to build our own people in and give them the space to grow.
It has helped me grow individually as well as professionally. The amount of awareness, the amount of exposure that India Foundation provides nationally as well as globally is unique.
The objective is clear: to create specialists, not generalists. There are people who are leading these initiatives for 5 years. So they become specialists.
It's the peer learning. Nobody works here in silos. Though there are 4 centers in India Foundation, yet all 4 centers help each other in carrying out its work.
Each one of them brings the core competency besides their specialization in their respective field. I think what they really bring is core integrity. It is that desire to do something for the country. I think that imbued spirit, we want to be change makers.
The working style of the foundation is far beyond the ideal setup. Here, we work not only to achieve the best, but also to improve and learn on day-to-day basis.
India Foundation is a Pathshala, which does not believe in creating just good research fellows. It believes in creating good leaders who can contribute to the society's well-being.
We want youngsters to come with fresh ideas, fresh knowledge, no baggage, no hangovers. Come afresh, understand India's potential, understand the preferences, priorities of the government of the day, and based on that, focus their research. So it's a new culture. I'm sure today these scholars look young, but it's a great opportunity for them to grow into eminent, established thinkers in their respective areas in a decade's time. The whole idea is to train youngsters into becoming in-depth scholars and thinkers.
India of the 21st century is different from India of the past centuries. Its aspirations are different, its strengths are different, its leadership is also different. It proactively wants to engage with outside world. It proactively wants to play a role in global politics. India Foundation sees an important role for itself in promoting the Indian ideas on the global stage.
India Foundation has emerged at the forefront of a renaissance in India, which involves the setting up of many domestic and global think tanks. This mirrors India's emergence on the international sphere. After many decades of being inward-looking, India is once again rediscovering its rightful role in helping to shape geopolitics.
A foundation which in a way has laid a strong foundation for informed debate in the country. It has laid foundation for people to come together, think together, apply themselves together, deal with challenging issues, not just by India, but by global community.
The ability to bring up new important concepts, bringing stakeholders together, and then establishing an entire ecosystem wherein which people can express ideas, communicate ideas. All these have been signal and landmark contributions.
It enables the policymaker to meet the other policymakers in an informal setting, not with the formal agendas. It enables policymakers to meet non-policymakers. Therefore, the ideas can come through much better.
These kind of initiatives, the Indian intellectuals coming together on platform, or the peace narrative through Dharma Dharma, or the security narrative through counterterrorism, or the global narrative of Indian Ocean, you can see very structured and systematic way making its impact.
With a new focus on neighborhood, with a new focus on the Indian Ocean, the entire Indian Ocean strategy of the Narendra Modi government has received special attention in the various conferences of India Foundation.
It is already addressing issues around the country. the fact that it is collaborating with state governments, and that is actually helping in spreading what I call the strategic culture all over India.
There has been large number of youth-related activities, whether they're in terms of research scholars, in terms of young thinkers, where we want to create a pipeline and an ecosystem of young people who are engaged on studying, analyzing, researching, and advocating areas of national importance.
It was very, very necessary to have a think tank which spoke differently, which opened up platform for different thought processes and truly Indian-based thought processes.
I see India Foundation more than a think tank. They are more action-oriented in terms of contributing to the key policy areas. And that, I think, has left a major footprint for many other research institutions to follow.
Not just going to be a simple think tank. We wanted to be more than a think tank, something that was more interventionist, something that could actually bring about the change.
The work of India Foundation actually started long before India Foundation was born. They used to have thinkers meet, where it was a very small closed-door gathering where we spoke of a lot of polity matters, media matters, etc. And over the years, that's how this developed.
In 2008, we may not have had the infrastructure. We had a clear idea of who we wanted to be, things that we believed in, issues that we wanted to pick up, policy initiatives that we wanted to research. These were things that were very important to us.
In 2009, when India Foundation really began, it was a brainchild of a few intellectuals of the country who were not happy with how conversations were, particularly when everything was looked at from one lens. I think the seed of that idea now has grown into a big tree, where we see the impact of those conversations really informing our policy measures.
Historically, India has never been home to many think tanks. In fact, that has been one of the challenges for us. India Foundation fills the void which was there of not having enough institutional support outside the government to make sure that government and society work together.
Through long-term interactions and focused engagements, India Foundation has built a decade of trust amongst policymakers and stakeholders.
The way it all started was that, you know, we set out on this journey and we were very candid and open and transparent about it. And along this side, we met with many co-travelers, shared that same feeling, the same passion, the same sentiment. They have invariably ended up becoming part of us. We have debated with them, we have argued with them, we have disagreed with them, but that has not stopped us from getting their expertise, getting their insight into this process.
In the course of these 10 years, India Foundation has developed cordial relations with many universities and think tanks in India and abroad.
India Foundation has tried to redefine itself, reinvent itself, time and again, trying to evolve a new paradigm.
Without an active participation of the northeast part of our country, it's very difficult to enact India's Act East policy. And this is where India Foundation, with its unique footprint across the country, has been able to create a value impact, wherein it has engaged with various stakeholders within the northeast part of the country, as well as the neighboring countries, culturally as well as civilizationally.
In these 10 years, it has emerged as one of the leading strategic think tanks of India. In India, the whole idea about strategic studies and the concept of security somehow always focused and dwelt only upon the borders. India Foundation was one of those which came forward and managed to change this perception.
What India Foundation has achieved is that it has come this far without compromising on the fundamentals on the basis of which it was set up. So it has not cut corners. It has not tried to be revisionist in its charter.
10 years is a good landmark. Many things achieved, but many more to be achieved. A journey has begun, but not yet completed. We'll continue on this path of thinking, working, and bringing people together.
Foundation is very action oriented in terms of delivery, in terms of engagements, in terms of productivity. I can meet a lot of experts from all around the world who inspire me, the icons that I look up to, and I've been able to meet with them and have discussions with them.
We have people who are lawyers, engineers, academicians, social scientists, political scientists, international relations experts. So when we all get together, a lot of different perspectives come into picture, and that is the greatest learning.
It's never really a tough day at India Foundation. Yes, you do face challenges, but we've been trained well and equipped well to deal with them day in and day out.
Visibility, credibility, and relevance. And I think on all these three parameters, India Foundation has come a long way.
India Foundation has a very multicultural team. We have people from across India, from various backgrounds that are here. So just sitting in an office that is so multicultural is a learning experience in itself.
We have a lot of youngsters. It is their thoughts and their ideas and their participation that has made it such a vibrant foundation.
You get to collaborate with fellow researchers on a wide range of subjects, which is sometimes not aligned to your area of research, but that is only a good thing because you get to learn more about a lot of things that you would otherwise not be focused on too much.
India Foundation is a very horizontal and a very meritocratic organization. Anyone who has a good idea can share that with the leadership. And if they find merit in this idea, they encourage young scholars and researchers to take a lead and execute these ideas.
We groom our own people. We groom our own talent. That we just don't go about acquiring talent, but we also get a chance to build our own people in and give them the space to grow.
It has helped me grow individually as well as professionally. The amount of awareness, the amount of exposure that India Foundation provides nationally as well as globally is unique.
The objective is clear, to create specialists, not generalists. There are people who are leading these initiatives for 5 years. So they become specialists.
It's the peer learning. Nobody works here in silos. Though there are four centers in India Foundation, yet all four centers help each other in carrying out its work.
Each one of them brings the core competency, besides their specialization in their respective field. I think what they really bring is core integrity. It is that desire to do something for the country. I think that imbued spirit, we want to be change makers.
The working style of the foundation is far beyond the ideal setup. Here, we work not only to achieve the best, but also to improve and learn on day-to-day basis.
India Foundation is a pathshala which does not believe in creating just good research fellows. It believes in creating good leaders who can contribute to the society's well-being.
We want youngsters to come with fresh ideas, fresh knowledge, no baggage, no hangovers. Come afresh, understand India's potential, understand the preferences, priorities of the government of the day, and based on that, focus their research. So it's a new culture. I'm sure today these scholars look young, but it's a great opportunity for them to grow into eminent, established thinkers in their respective areas in a decade's time. The whole idea is to train youngsters into becoming in-depth scholars and thinkers.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I wish you all a very warm welcome to this evening. The Honorable Vice President, Honorable Venkat Naidu Garu is on his way. He will be here any minute. May I request you all to kindly take your seats. Ladies and gentlemen, we have our honorable chief guest for this evening, Sri Venkat Naidu Garu. May I request you all to kindly rise to welcome him. I request that you be seated. Apologies, he will be here in 5 minutes.
India of the 21st century is different from India of the past centuries. Its aspirations are different, its strengths are different, its leadership is also different. It proactively wants to engage with outside world. It proactively wants to play a role in global politics. India Foundation sees an important role for itself in promoting the Indian ideas on the global stage.
India Foundation has emerged at the forefront of a renaissance in India, which involves the setting up of many domestic and global think tanks. This mirrors India's emergence on the international sphere. After many decades of being inward-looking, India is once again rediscovering its rightful role in helping to shape geopolitics.
A foundation which in a way has laid a strong foundation for informed debate in the country. It has laid foundation for people to come together, think together, apply themselves together, deal with challenging issues, not just by India, but by global community.
The ability to bring up new important concepts, bringing stakeholders together, and then establishing an entire ecosystem wherein which people can express ideas, communicate ideas. All these have been signal and landmark contributions.
It enables the policymaker to meet the other policymakers in an informal setting, not with the formal agendas. It enables policymakers to meet non-policymakers. Therefore, the ideas can come through much better.
These kind of initiatives, the Indian intellectuals coming together on platform, or the peace narrative through Dharma Dharma, or the security narrative through counterterrorism, or the global narrative of Indian Ocean, you can see very structured and systematic way making its impact.
With a new focus on neighborhood, with a new focus on the Indian Ocean, the entire Indian Ocean strategy of the Narendra Modi government has received special attention in the various conferences of India Foundation.
It is already addressing issues around the country. The fact that it is collaborating with state governments, and that is actually helping in spreading what I call the strategic culture all over India.
There has been large number of youth-related activities, whether they're in terms of research scholars, in terms of young thinkers, where we want to create a pipeline and an ecosystem of young people who are engaged on studying, analyzing, researching, and advocating areas of national importance.
It was very, very necessary to have a think tank which spoke differently, which opened up platform for different thought processes and truly Indian-based thought processes.
I see India Foundation more than a think tank. They are more action-oriented in terms of contributing to the key policy areas. And that, I think, has left a major footprint for many other research institutions to follow.
Apologies for the delay. We're starting in 2 minutes. May I request everybody to kindly take your seats. Our Honorable Vice President is here. May I request you all to kindly rise to welcome him. Kindly remain risen for the national anthem.
जनगणमन अधिनायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड उत्कल वंगा विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्चल जलधि तरंगा तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मागे गाहे तव जय गाथा जनगण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे
Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of India Foundation, I'm delighted to welcome you all to the third Atal Bihari Vajpayee Memorial Lecture on the occasion of the 96th birth anniversary of one of India's tallest leaders and greatest statesmen, Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee. The first Atal Bihari Vajpayee Memorial Lecture was delivered by our former finance minister, Sri Arun Jaitliji, in New Delhi in 2018 on Indian democracy, maturity, and challenges. The second lecture in 2019 was delivered by our former President of India, Sri Pranab Mukherjee, on as parliamentary democracy succeeded in India and the challenges ahead. And today, I am delighted and honored to welcome our chief guest for this evening, the Honorable Vice President of India and our beloved Sri Venkaiah Naiduji, to deliver the third Atal Bihari Vajpayee Memorial Lecture on Building Democratic Consensus, the Vajpayee Way. I invite Vice Admiral Shekhar Sinhaji, Member Board of Trustees, India Foundation, to kindly deliver the welcome address. Vice Admiral Shekhar Ji is the first Commander-in-Chief of the Western Naval Command of the Indian Navy. He has been awarded the Param Vishisht and Ati Vishisht Seva Medals for exceptional service and has also been conferred with two gallantry awards. He is currently a member of the Board of Trustees of India Foundation. Over to you, sir.
I am both honored and privileged to welcome Honorable Vice President of India, Sri Venkaiah Naiduji, who has accepted our invitation to come here and deliver the third Atal Bihari Vajpayee Memorial Lecture. I also wish to welcome our members of the Board of Governors here, Ram Madhavji and Shaurya Dovalji, who are here, and of course the distinguished guests. I need not say very much about Honorable Sri Venkaiah Naiduji. All of us know that in public life he has a very tall standing and a very experienced politician. He has not only understood, but the manner in which he's run the Rajya Sabha proceedings, it's a treat to watch. And therefore, we thought that the past two speakers were all people of that stature. And for delivering the talk on Bharat Ratna Shri Atal Bihari Vajpayee Ji Memorial Lecture, we thought Sri Venkaiah Naiduji is the most suitable person to do this. So may I, without wasting any time, invite the Honorable Vice President to speak. Okay. There is a video, sir. Okay, okay.
Thank you, Admiral Shekhar Sinhaji. Ladies and gentlemen, Sri M. Venkaiah Naidu Garu is the third Vice President of India and the Chairman of the Rajya Sabha. Previously, he served as the Minister of Housing, Urban Poverty Alleviation, Urban Development, and Information and Broadcasting from 2014 to 2017. Beginning as an ordinary worker in the ABVP, he rose to become the National President of the BJP between 2002 and 2004. He also served as the Union Cabinet Minister for Rural Development in the Atal Bihari Vajpayee government. Both as a student and a political leader, Sri Naidu Garu gained prominence for his oratory skills. Although he keeps a very busy schedule, being the Vice President and the Chairman of the Rajya Sabha, he never gives up his penchant for reading and serious academic work, which is evidenced by the fact that he publishes in the mainstream media on a regular basis on important issues of public concern and national importance. He's the modern Odysseus, symbolizing relentless journey and tireless voice. His speeches are replete with wit and humor, eloquently enunciating serious issues. As a perfectionist, he never compromises on quality in anything which is the reason for his success and reputation. As a minister in the Vajpayee Ji's cabinet and as a party functionary, Sri Venkaiah Naidu Garu closely followed the former prime minister and thoroughly understood the man and his message. There will be no better leader than him to address us this evening. We will have a short video on Sri Atalji prepared by India Foundation, following which I will have the honor of inviting our Honorable Vice President of India to deliver the third Atal Bihari Vajpayee Memorial Lecture. Here is the video.
की घोर घटाए पामों के नीचे अंगारे सर पर बरसे यदि ज्वालाए निज हाथों से हंसते हंसते आग लगाकर चलना होगा कदम मिलाकर चलना होगा हास्य रुदन में तूफानों में अमर संख्यक बलिदानों में उद्यानों में वीरानों में अपमानों में सम्मानों में उन्नत मस्तक उभरा सीना पीड़ाओं में पलना होगा कदम मिलाकर चलना होगा
Probably one of the greatest orators that India has seen, a product of parliamentary democracy, a man who always measured his words, a man who had the capacity to place national interest higher than his own party interest. What do I regard as his greatest achievement? Indian democracy, because of two political parties as national parties, became a viable parliamentary democracy.
As a statesman and a political stalwart, he dominated the national space for a very long period of time. As a prime minister, he kept the nation first. As a Democrat, he was one of the few leaders who thought of every angle before taking a decision.
उस समय के प्रधानमंत्री नरसिंह राव जी ने भारत का पक्ष रखने के लिए मुझे विरोधी दल के नेता के नाते जेनेवा भेजा था और पाकिस्तानी उसे देखकर चमत्कृत रह गए। उन्होंने कहा कि ये कहां से आए, क्योंकि उनके यहां विरोधी दल का नेता ऐसे राष्ट्रीय कार्य में भी सहयोग देने के लिए तैयार नहीं होता। वो हर जगह अपने सरकार को गिराने के काम में लगा रहता है। ये हमारी परंपरा।
परंपरा नहीं है, ये हमारी प्रकृति नहीं है। और मैं चाहता हूं ये परंपरा बनी रहे, ये प्रकृति बनी रहे। सत्ता का खेल तो चलेगा, सरकारें आएंगी जाएंगी, पार्टियां बनेंगी बिगड़ेंगी, मगर ये देश रहना चाहिए, इस देश का लोकतंत्र अमर रहना चाहिए।
कोई व्यक्ति कितना भी बड़ा हो मगर देश से बड़ा नहीं हो सकता। व्यक्ति आएंगे चले जाएंगे, मगर कश्मीर से लेकर कन्याकुमारी तक फैला हुआ भारत अपनी सनातन संस्कृति के साथ आधुनिकता का वर्णन करने के लिए अमर काल तक इस तीर्थ यात्रा में चलता रहेगा।
टूटे हुए सपने की सुने कौन सिसकी, टूटे हुए सपने की सुने कौन सिसकी, अंतर को चीर व्यथा पलकों पर ठिठकी, हार नहीं मानूंगा रार नहीं ठानूंगा, काल के कपाल पर लिखता मिटाता हूं, गीत नया गाता हूं, गीत नया गाता हूं।
वाइस एडमिरल शेखर सिन्हा जी, श्री शौर्य डोवल, श्री राम माधव, श्री किशन रेड्डी यूनियन मिनिस्टर, लॉट ऑफ एनलाइटेंड पीपल ऑफ दिस famous historical city of Hyderabad. Dear brothers and sisters, I'm happy to be amidst you all today. But at the same time, I'm not that much comfortable. One, because of the present situation and the arrangement that has to be made. You know that I have the habit of meeting people, greeting people, talking with people, walking with the people, spending time with the people. Now I am not able to do it. One is because of the protocol. Second is this pandemic. Because I have the habit of going nearer to the people, talking to them, knowing from them, and then move on. But this position of the constitutional responsibility and also the present position, where most of the things are virtual, not actual, though virtual is factual as of now. We are meeting in a hybrid this thing. That's why I said I am not that much comfortable. But at the same time, so this is a reality and we have to carry on with that for some more time. I hope better days will come and we'll be able to, the world for that matter, will be able to come out of this present situation. We all have gathered here today to pay homage to one of the tallest leaders, most respected, admired, not only in India, but also world over. His vision accelerated economic reforms. Reforms were initiated by late P.V. Narasimha Rao ji. I have no hesitation in saying it, but implementation part, acceleration
of the same process was actually done by Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee. He fast-tracked development in various sectors, ranging from Gram Sadak Yojana to air connectivity, rail connectivity, and also teleconnectivity, port connectivity, even political connectivity also. He brought many parties together for the first time in India's history. And he was able to provide an able leadership and also a stable government. That is the speciality of this great man. He was a towering intellectual and an orator for excellence. I don't think there is any comparison to this great man as far as the speeches are concerned. He used to inspire millions of the people across the country, particularly younger generation. He has endeared himself to the masses and struck an instant chord with them with his down-to-earth simplicity and disarming innocence, displaying an amenable, natural way of communicating, conducting, and he has no enemies but only friends in politics, very rare quality. That is the need of the hour. One of the reasons for this memorial lectures is to recall the greatness of these great leaders, the contributions they have made, the standards they have set in. They should be known to the younger generation so that they get inspiration. That is the purpose of this memorial lectures. When Ram asked me, I readily agreed. For the reason, it's an occasion to recall the memories of this great son of this great country. Not because he and I, we used to belong to the same political thought. I am no more a politician. Admiral Shekhar Sinhaji was just introducing me. Politician, I am no more a politician, I left politics. I will not enter politics, I can assure you. But I will be in public life, undoubtedly. Because we have chosen this path to serve the people in whatever responsibility we have. Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee was a man of impeccable integrity and high moral values, setting high ethical standards in public life. He never compromised on values in which he believed. That is an important aspect to be understood by the present generation of politicians and also people in public life. Maintaining standards, ethics, moral values, which were part of India's heritage and culture, which our forefathers have given to us through thousands of years of civilization. Slowly, there is some amount of erosion. I'll come to it a little later. I really would like to compliment India Foundation for organizing this series of memorial lectures. Friends, I can tell you, I had the privilege of learning from working with Sri late Atalji over a period of long association with him, around 40 years. For the information of some of our friends, I started my career as a student activist, and I used to announce about the arrival of this great man to my town in Nellore. Sitting in a tonga, jatka, what do you call, एंड अनाउंस आज शाम को तरुण हृदय सम्राट श्री अटल बिहारी वाजपेयी जी हमारा शहर में आने वाले हैं. कोपरेटिव मैदान में आम सभा होगा. आप सब लोग नॉट इन हिंदी ऑफ कोर्स इन तेलुगु इन माय ओन लैंग्वेज इन माय ओन टाउन. दैट्स हाउ आई यूज्ड टू. बट आई नेवर इमेजिन दैट दैट बॉय हू मेड एन अनाउंसमेंट अबाउट द अराइवल ऑफ दिस ग्रेट लीडर विल गेट एन ऑपर्चुनिटी टू बिकम द प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ द रूलिंग पार्टी and sit between Atal Bihari Vajpayee and Advani. I feel that was a great opportunity. God and people have bestowed on me. In fact, not only me, many in my generation, Atalji and Advani ji were gurus, guides, philosophers, and mentors. I have no hesitation to say it. While recalling my association with Atalji, I am overwhelmed by the affection and memories. Not only affection to colleagues and particular youngsters, but also the manner of perfection. He used to accomplish the responsibilities that were given to him. From time to time. The love, affection he has shown to me in my younger days, I can never forget it. That is the foundation for my public life. Talking about Sri Atalji is like exploring a sea. Deep ocean. You can speak for hours, for days, and months. There is so much to learn. He had many facets that made him a total personality. He was both Atal and Bihari. He was Atal, strong, and Bihari. True to his name, of course, he conveyed himself as a man of firm words and deeds and a dreamer. He epitomized the politics of conviction and consensus. That is the speciality of this great man. Conviction and consensus. That is what is required now, conviction. He was an embodiment of courage, caliber, capacity, conduct, and character worthy of emulation. So I tell the younger generation, go through the speeches, the life of this great man who has risen from the grassroots level to that highest office of the Prime Minister and excelled in that. Having born in 1924, he witnessed the freedom struggle and the birth pangs of our nation at the stroke of midnight. This early impression kept him rooted all the time to the cause of contributing to the building of a new India. Since entering the parliament first time in 1957, he kept on making significant contribution to public life, to the parliamentary discourse, and also the development of the country in various capacities. Atalji was the first Prime Minister backed by the longest parliament career, I think. Experience of around 40 years. As a parliamentarian, he has enriched the debates with the force of his thoughts and convictions and flow of language, the language at his command, in the English, was really amazing. The punch and the wit and his occasional poetic expressions. Even the late Prime Minister Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru was very much impressed by his oratorial and effective interventions in Parliament. The infectious smile of Atalji endeared him to all around and helped him to connect with the masses effortlessly. That smile of Atalji remains to be his insignia. We sadly miss his presence. Behind that smile of Atalji, there was a steel resolve that guided his words and deeds. His 13-day stint as Prime Minister for the first time, 13-month second tenure, and subsequent full term of 5 years as the Prime Minister was a clear indication of the emergence of consolidation of new spirit of nationalism. Reflecting the change in the mindset of the people, we are now witnessing a further consolidation of the spirit. Atalji, for the understanding, was the first non-Congress Prime Minister to have served a full term in office, and this has its own significance. During his Prime Ministry between 1998 and 2004, Atalji has pioneered several policy and programmatic initiatives with an intention to make a difference to the development of our country. That was the purpose. The purpose of reforms is to make the life of the common man better. That is the purpose of any reform for that matter. He wanted to make a difference to the lives of the people. It was a golden era for the economy. I have no hesitation to say it, as it grew at a rate of 8% per year. He steadfastly pushed several major reforms and paid rich dividends. Atalji has said, I would like to quote, empowering the individual is empowering the nation. Empowering the individual is empowering nation. So there is a debate going on, unnecessary debate. What is nationalism? Nationalism is thinking about the nation and its people. Chala mandi maadutu untaru. జాతీయవాదం అంటే ఏంది? జాతి హితమే జాతీయవాదం. దేశభక్తి అంటే ఏంది? గురజాడ అప్పారావు గారు చెప్పారు కదా, దేశం అంటే మట్టి కాదు, దేశం అంటే మనుషుడు. మనుషుల యొక్క ఉన్నతి, వాళ్ళ సంతోషము, వాళ్ళ సౌభాగ్యము, అది అసలైన జాతీయవాదం అంటే. అంతేకాని కేవలం భారత మాతకు జయ అని, వందే మాత్రం అని జిందాబాదు చెప్తే జయము కాదు. ఈ దేశంలో ఉన్న కోట్లాది మంది ప్రజలకు జయమొగ్గాక అని దాని ఉద్దేశం. దాన్ని మనం అందరం ఆచరించేటి ప్రయత్నం చేయాల్సిన అవసరం ఉంది. హీ బ్రాట్ ర్యాపిడ్ ఎకనమిక్ చేంజెస్ అండ్ ఆల్సో సోషల్ చేంజెస్. హీ ఇనిషియేటెడ్ అండ్ హీ వర్క్డ్ contributed subsequently towards that goal. Despite heading a coalition government, Atalji as a Prime Minister kept on focus on untangling the hurdles that were coming in the way of socio-economic transformation. He gave a big push to increase the domestic and foreign investment, modernization of public and industrial infrastructure, creation of jobs, rising high-tech. This high-tech, I think, was inaugurated by Atal Bihari Vajpayee. And IT industry, and urban modernization, and expansion. These initiatives improved the international image of our country. India was recognized and respected during his tenure. Of course, thanks to the Pokhran II, which he did in spite of sanctions and threats from those big so-called powers. India's image, of course, now is further reached heights, but the beginning was made by Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee of reforming various systems. Atalji ushered in a connectivity revolution by aggressively pursuing the building of national highways, Swarna Chaturbhuja Yojana, Golden Quadrilateral, promoting communication of infrastructure. He introduced the path-breaking Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana. Friends, I was privileged to be the Rural Development Minister at that time. Atalji was Vikas Purush in true sense. Atalji shared and was a lover of peace and harmony. Peace is the prerequisite for progress. If you have tension, you cannot pay attention and have the retention. Otherwise, it will be only pretension. You have to work for peace. The people want to live in peace. They want to live in harmony, not only in India, worldwide. Some leaders of the nations, including one of our neighbors, they may be trying to mislead them from time to time and create tensions, forgetting the progress. But it is the peace which is the prerequisite of a progress. I strongly have that conviction. He has taken far-reaching initiatives to improve ties with neighboring countries, including the troubling neighbor. Because you know the famous quotation that was just explained, that you can change your friends, but you can't change your neighbors. What we are trying to change is their mindset. Buddhi antame, dani marche prayatnam chestunnam. Because we want to live in harmony with all, including our neighbor. As External Affairs Minister in the Janata government and later as Prime Minister, he guided the country's foreign policy on the foundation of ancient values of our land of peaceful coexistence. Our heritage, our culture, our civilization taught us to live in peaceful harmony with others, coexistence. We go through the history of this great nation. We are one of the oldest ancient civilizations. Some of them, which were very famous at the time, they are no more that much popular. But our civilization, the reason is because of the basic foundations. Vasudhaika Kutumbakam, Sarve Jana Sukhina Bhavantu. Share and care is the core of our Indian philosophy. That should be understood by all. And this pandemic times, we have some time. Everyone should really, there is a pause to think and also introspect how we have lived our lives, how we have to plan our future, how we have to conduct ourselves, and then reset our minds. Some time has been made available. This, everybody should think on those lines. The steely resolve of the soft-spoken Atalji was evident in conducting nuclear tests in 1998. Even more significant was the way in which he steered the country through economic sanctions imposed on the country after Pokhran II. He did not bother. did not succumb to the pressure. The way Atalji handled the misadventure of our neighbor in Kargil, 1999, was an indication of firmness and the clarity of thought of his style of working. The way the leading powers of the world refused to condone the aggression of our neighbor. But still, this man stood firm, and he has handled various aspects of the conflict that were thrust upon our nation. After the success of Operation Vijay in Kargil, the statesman Atalji was keen to restore normalcy with the aggressor, but the military-minded rulers botched up his good intentions. You know the Agra summit. It has been suggested to me to speak on building democratic consensus, the Vajpayee way. For Atalji, consensus was not an expedient political tool. It was a core element of his convictions. He was a democratic to the core, and accordingly, consensus building was a natural corollary. Being fully conversant with the diversity of our country, the consensual approach was his preferred methodology. It was this spirit of democracy that made Atal Bihari Vajpayee widely acceptable across the social and political spectrum. Atalji became the Prime Minister when the body polity was in a state of flux. Unstable coalition governments were the order of the day. I believe that the attribute of consensus-seeking of Atalji enabled him to successfully lead a large coalition into a full-term 23 political parties. 23. Divergent political opinions. He was patient till the point of requirement. He was open to various points of view and good at forging the broadest acceptable position. The fact that Atalji pushed several reforms as the head of the coalition holds mirror to this commendable quality of carrying all with him. At the same time, he did demonstrate that consensus does not necessarily mean compromise all the time. This has to be understood. Many people say consensus, without consensus, how do you move on? Consensus do not mean total acceptance. It's not, in the present day situation, it's not possible for us. But broad agreement, large agreement. We must work towards forging such an agreement. Never used to compromise, but used to give in, give opportunity, try to understand others, try to make them to understand him, his policies and his initiatives. He made a significant contribution in the domain of coalition politics by leading a coalition for a full term of 5 years. In the center for the first time, he led two coalition governments and guided the maturation of coalitions. Hence, I have no hesitation in calling Atalji as the father of coalition practices in our country. A coalition government is but natural to be pulled in different directions by the constituents who bring into play different kinds of pressures on the leadership. I was a witness to this as the president of the ruling party at that time, how different parties used to pull in different directions. But he used to quietly, smilingly, patiently, used to hear all of them, give them an opportunity, and then carry forward the broad consensus. He had a lot of patience. but not a political patient. He tried to evolve consensus by persuasion. Since medieval times, the diversity of our country has further expanded. This warrants enhanced commitment to consensus building in mounting a collective effort towards building a new India. The assertion of Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, Viswas, the call given by the present Prime Minister, Sri Narendra Bhai Modi, is an affirmation of the commitment to the spirit of inclusive and democratic governance and the continuation of Sriman Atal Bihari Vajpayee's legacy. The Constitution of India and our parliament institutions offer clear guidance and opportunities for a negotiated resolution of various issues. Every contentious issue can be resolved through dialogue and discussion. There is a record of several such major issues having been resolved that way. Atalji, all through his long stint in public life and as Prime Minister, inspired the people of the country and enjoyed their goodwill and confidence. It was primarily because the way he conveyed himself and was understood by the people. The core elements of this mutually beneficial relationship of our adherence to the principles of democracy, spirit of accommodating and forging a common position. How difficult it is, I know. Earlier, as the president of that party to which I belonged to at that time, now as the chairman of the upper house. Atalji was an embodiment of decency, dignity, decorum, at the same time demonstrated necessary dynamism. I would like to call the path and practice adopted by vision of Atal Bihari Vajpayee, I call it as Atal School of Politics and Values. There is so much need, necessity for bringing such values and following the Atal School of Politics and Values that helped our country in a critical juncture. Sri Vajpayee ji gave primacy to economic reforms and the fact that he created a separate ministry of disinvestment bears testimony to this important aspect of his governance. One of the pioneering initiatives was introduction of Fiscal Responsibility and Budget Management Act, FRBM, which sought to curb government spending and limit fiscal deficit to 3% by 2008. This is very much necessary in the present day where populism, people think populism will make you popular. Sometimes it makes people pauper. But you are seeing that tendency. When you make promises or announce programs, you don't bother. Where are the resources? And there is a possibility of getting loans, but how do you repay the loans? Jo aane wale hai wo dekhenge. I remember a small thing which I quote everywhere. When I was a student activist, I used to hear the speeches. Some leader saying, "Anni panchala, panchala, panchala. Anni panchala ante distribute." I used to get a doubt. Panchali ante mundu penchali kada. Penchakunda panchite, adi matre migulutundi. Anni pothe. I have to make ordinary people understand who are watching this program. I am saying that. And those were the thoughts those days. I would not have used that now. But that's sort of idea. So you have to really create wealth and distribute wealth to keep the health of the nation, economy. So this FRBM Act, it's a very radical very important contribution he made in by evolving broad consensus. He was instrumental in giving a huge flip to the infrastructure in the country. And Golden Quadrilateral Project, Yellow City reforms, telecom connectivity, rail connectivity, air connectivity, providing free elementary education were some of the other significant initiatives. There are many taken under his leadership. The erosion of values in public life, more so in the political arena and also in the media, is not only a matter of concern, serious concern, but needs to be urgently arrested with the involvement of all the citizens. I am talking the present day politics. Present day means not today's this party here or that party there and all in, over the years. The values are being eroded. The standards are compromised. We have to arrest this at the earliest. That is possible with the involvement of the people. Otherwise, people will lose faith in political class. We must make a concerted and collective action towards cleansing this system and promoting clean politics. It is the duty of all political parties to ensure that their members, including parliamentarians, legislators, maintain ethical conduct at all times and at all places. I also urge young politicians to read the debates of the Constituent Assembly, the great speeches made by great parliamentarians, veteran parliamentarians subsequently, from Nath Pai to Vajpayee, to Bhupesh Gupta, to Hiren Mukherjee, to Indrajit Gupta, to Pilu Modi, to M.R. Masani, to Professor Acharya Ranga, to many. I need not recall all the names. Many. At the present younger generation, parliamentarians, they must really go through those debates and see the level of debate, the decency, decorum the leaders used to maintain, because we are seeing fall of standards, not only in parliament, but also in various state legislatures. This is unfortunate. This makes the people to lose faith in the leadership. People used to admire politicians. Now, the admiration levels are coming down. There are some politicians, of course, even today, respected. Some are respected because of their conduct and admiration. Some are respected because of the position they are holding. We must see to it, the younger generation of politicians, that we stand by conviction. Small, small things, one has to take care. And those great leaders used to guide the youngsters those days. There is a need to raise the level of debates, both in legislature outside, the level of discourses. And we are talking of this great man. It is the time to reflect on what is happening, the level of debates, the standard of speeches that are being made. I need not recall all the speeches this pious evening of the present day, some of the politicians. So I feel there is a need to raise the level of debates, follow standards, avoid unruly behavior, physical fights at some places. Physical fights also. And some people will, because of this, their name is appearing in the media. Media also has a responsibility. This is not a behavior to be reported in the front page also in a positive manner. We must condemn. But unfortunately, you create disturbance, you get prominence. You be constructive, you are not even reported. This is an unfortunate way of things that are happening in sections of the media. So I suggest to the media also, please to see to it that constructive attitudes, not the destructive or obstructive attitudes, are given prominence or encouraged. When I see in Parliament, even today, there are some MPs, I can tell you, my countrymen, there are some people who prepare well, make wonderful contribution to the debates of the House, but they are going unnoticed, not reported properly. And what is reported is unruly behavior, abusive language used by some people, undemocratic methods. And by giving prominence to such people, instead of condemning them, you are destroying the health of the nation. So we must follow 3D principle. Avoid the 4th D. Discuss, debate, and decide. Avoid the 4th D, disrupt. I always tell my colleagues in Parliament, let the government propose, let the opposition oppose. Let the government propose, let the opposition oppose, and let the House decide. Propose, oppose, then leave it to the House to decide. You can't have your way simply by raising your voice or doing unparliamentary things and all, and say it's a brute majority. Majority is majority, na? You have to discuss, debate, and decide. And then that is the way forward. And create awareness among the people and wait for your opportunity. Wait for your opportunity. The absence of value-based politics, lack of ideology, that's another important thing. Hunger for power, muscle and money power, and the entry of people with criminal background into politics is leading to violence in political arena and debasing politics. Unless these undesirable trends are checked, the situation will further deteriorate and cause irreparable damage to the country's polity and the people. అందుకే నేను తరచుగా చెప్తూ ఉంటాను, మన ప్రవర్తన ప్రజలు గమనిస్తూ ఉన్నారు. సమ్ టైమ్స్ దే బికమ్ సైలెంట్ స్పెక్టేటర్స్. దే అప్రిషియేట్ ది సైలెంట్ మెజారిటీ, దో ద వైలెంట్ మైనారిటీ. మైనారిటీ ఈజ్ నాట్ ఇన్ రిలీజియస్ టర్మ్స్, మైనారిటీ ఆఫ్ ద నంబర్స్ ఇన్ ద హౌస్. దే గెట్ ప్రామినెన్స్, పీపుల్ డోంట్ లైక్ ఇట్. దట్స్ వై ఐ టెల్ budding politicians, don't be carried away by the 10%. Taliya bajane wale, ah, badhiya bola re, acha abuse kiya. They are only 10%. Because that 10% is vocal. But the 90% are silent. These 10% are violent, but the people are silent. The other majority, 90%, is silent. People will keep that in mind. This has to be understood by one and all in politics. And another aspect is about the anti-defection. The anti-defection loopholes has to be further plugged. And the defection cases. In a democracy, one has got every right to change the parties. If you don't like the leader, if you don't like the policies in a particular issue after persuasion, you are not able to convince, then okay. But that should be an issue. Siddhantam kanna radhantam ekoyip. Adi kaadu manaku kavalsindi. Ee party firayimpulu prajaswamyanni apahasyam chestunnayi, balahina parustunnayi. Veetini nirodhinchali. Ee party firayimpulanu adhikarulu evaraithe అధ్యక్షులు, ప్రిసైడింగ్ ఆఫీసర్స్, వాటిని సకాలంలో పరిష్కరించాలి. మనం చూస్తూ ఉంటాం, 3 నెలల లోపల పరిష్కరించాలని నేను ఆ మధ్య తీర్పు కూడా ఇచ్చాను. నా తీర్పు నా సభకి, మిగతా వాళ్ళకి తెరవడం కోసం. కానీ కొన్ని చోట్ల 2 సంవత్సరాలు 3 సంవత్సరాలు ఇక్కడ గెలిచి అక్కడ మంత్రి, అక్కడ గెలిచి ఇక్కడ మంత్రి నడుస్తూ ఉంది. ఇది మంచిది కాదు. ఐఎమ్ నాట్ నేనేది ఒక పార్టీని గురించో ఒక రాష్ట్రాన్ని గురించి ప్రస్తావించలేదు, ప్రస్తావించాల్సిన విషయం కూడా కాదు నాకు తెలిసి. అందుకని దీన్ని సరిదిద్దాల్సి ఉంది, 10th షెడ్యూల్. అదర్వైజ్ యు ఆర్ మేకింగ్ ఏ మోకరీ ఆఫ్ డెమోక్రసీ. ఈ ది డిఫెక్షన్ మ్యాటర్స్ కెనాట్ రిమైన్ అన్డిసైడెడ్ ఫర్ లాంగర్ పీరియడ్స్. విల్ బి మేకింగ్ ఏ మోకరీ ఆఫ్ డెమోక్రసీ. I feel the time has come to political parties to think, introspect, and bid goodbye to politics of convenience and practice politics of conviction, politics of consensus. Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee was an ideal politician who unwaveringly stood by his conviction, be it giving up the post of the Prime Minister, not succumbing to the pressure from the USA on our country and the nuclear issue. He just gave up the post of Prime Minister. He lost by one vote. One vote. Can you imagine now how people are trying to manipulate? So his remarkable ability to be tolerant and accommodating others' viewpoints enabled him to smoothly run a coalition government, as I said earlier. And also I call upon the political parties to put an end to populism and accord priority for long-term development. Samitha Vandagada. Chapagalante, chapa patte the nirpitsale gani. చేపను ఉచితంగా ఇవ్వడం అలవాటు చేస్తే మధ్యాహ్నం మట్టగుడిసిస్తే సాయంత్రం కొరమేన కావాలని అడుగుతాడు. సహజం అది. డిఫరెంట్ టైప్స్ ఆఫ్ ఫిష్ పేరు చెప్పి బొచ్చు కావచ్చు, లేదా కొరమేన కావచ్చు, ఇంకేదో కావచ్చు, ఏదో పేరు రకరకాల పేరు. అందుకని ఎలా పట్టుకోవాలి చేపలు నేర్పించామనుకోండి పట్టుకోగలడు, అలాగే ఎలా పైకి రావాలి, ఎలా ముందుకు వెళ్ళాలి అనే విషయాన్ని మనం నేర్పించగలిగితే దానికి కావాల్సిన ప్రోత్సాహం ఇవ్వాలి. ఇట్స్ ద డ్యూటీ ఆఫ్ ద గవర్నమెంట్ టు గో ఫర్ హెల్పింగ్ ది వీకర్ సెక్షన్, గివింగ్ ఎ హెల్పింగ్ హ్యాండ్. లిటిల్ బయాస్ ఇన్ ఫేవర్ ఆఫ్ ద పూర్, ఇన్ ఫేవర్ ఆఫ్ ద అన్ఆర్గనైజ్డ్, ఇన్ ఫేవర్ ఆఫ్ ద రూరల్ పీపుల్, ఇన్ ఫేవర్ ఆఫ్ ద ఉమెన్, బికాస్ దే హ్యావ్ బీన్ డిస్క్రిమినేటెడ్. వీకర్ సెక్షన్స్, ఉమెన్, రూరల్ పీపుల్, because they don't have a level, they were not given a level playing field earlier. So this has to be understood. So we must all really, because today is the occasion of remembering the great contribution made by this great man, I am tempted to make some of these mentions about what is happening and all, and also the way people are getting disgusted, disillusioned. This has to be understood by all. Over the years, decadence has crept into various walks of life, and we frequently witness corrupt practices with an all-round decline in values and ethics. Corruption is a major menace that is eating into the vitals of our system and must be combated with resolute determination at all levels. It is not that much easy, I know that. You are seeing what is happening. But if you have the determination, if you have the conviction, you will succeed if you make a beginning. Today, my dear friends, brothers and sisters, India is a young country with 65% of our population below 35 years, 50% of our population around 25 years. The youth of the country must be in the forefront in eliminating corruption, in fighting corruption. Discrimination of any form, violence against women, and the problems of poverty. The youth must be in the forefront to fight these menaces. The present day youth and politicians must learn from Sriman Atal Bihari Vajpayee. He started his career as an ordinary worker and reached this level continuously never thought of changing parties. We must have that much patience. We should not be succumbed to opportunism and temptation of power. So nowadays you know that if you don't get a reservation in Godavari, then try to catch the Visakha Express and reach the place. Because we have to reach the place. That should not be the way in politics. So that's why we recall the life of this great man, how he worked, how he used to give speeches. People used to come in thousands, but his party never used to win an election. There was a time when under his leadership, they got only 2 seats, but patiently. Went around the country. Practiced what he believed. Promoted his own conviction, ideology. And then promoted that. You are seeing how the change has come. Before concluding, I would like to appeal to the people to elect their representatives on the basis of 4 C's, which I often say. Character, caliber, capacity, and conduct. That should be the beginning. But unfortunately, the other 4 C's are creeping into our system. Character, caliber, capacity, and conduct. The other 4 C's are caste, community, cash, and criminality. These 4 C's are trying to dominate. That is not a healthy thing for our system. We should not become hostage to such forces. Our country, as I told you, is an ancient civilization. We are the largest parliamentary democracy in the world. We should maintain that traditions and then set example to other countries by following the rich traditions of democracy. And we really should promote that sort of ideological issue-based politics rather than carried away by temporary emotive issues. My dear friends, I would have been more comfortable, but for this protocol, I can't speak whatever I intend to speak, because there is a limit. I am in a position, and moreover, and it's always uncomfortable to me to go through the notes. Because my people tell me, so please, I understand. And then I will be more comfortable in coming to you all people, meeting you, greeting you, exchanging views. But the one is protocol, other is pandemic. They say, no, sir, come to the dais. Welcome. Then Janaganamana. Then speech. Then Janaganamana. Then leave. But I try to change it. I've changed it. But now, because of this pandemic again, we have to follow that. Because though I'm tempted to seeing many of the stalwarts sitting here, some of the very popular faces of Hyderabad and also known acquaintances of me, but I can't help it. I'm not able to get down and come to you, spend time with you, which is not in the interest of you and all. I told, in fact, these people also, open the doors here. At least we can have open door policy here, not the other in the political air. Because you might have seen this pandemic also, air circulation is one of the important aspects. That's why some of you might have seen, I am giving interviews, appointments on the lawns of my house, under the tree. So that this virus pollutants, they can evaporate easily. But we are slowly getting to the closed life. Everything is closed from all sides. Mind also is closed. Not a good thing. We must have proper ventilation. The fashion nowadays. Recently, when I went to my daughter's house and then here, and then saw, then I asked them, hey, who is the architect of this? And also, sir, the architect is outside, but it's interior decorator who has made it. I said, call. They said, she's a youngster girl. I said, call her, no problem. Call. Then I asked her, come to the bathroom. I took her to bathroom and shown her the, the wash basin. The water that is pouring in the wash basin is totally coming out, including it coming on your body also. Chepanaki, Amma, Saundaryama, Saukaryama. Saukaryam mukhyam, Saundaryam kadu. Comfort and convenience, not the fashion. So we must also learn lessons from this pandemic and develop physical fitness and also eat hygiene food. I might have it everywhere, anywhere I am addressing any gathering, I am stressing on these 2 points. And you know the pandemic, in spite of its massive toll across the globe, comparatively, we are in a better position, though we are one of the largest nations after the other country. Other country, you don't know what has happened inside, what is happening also. But democratic country is India. Still, the reason being the endurance of our lifestyle, mostly. But slowly, lifestyle is changing. And so eating proper food is important. And also following physical fitness also is equally important. These 2 things I thought I should tell the people. And I would like to once again thank the organizers for this wonderful opportunity. And also would like to thank you all that you have all made it to this meeting about a memorial lecture of this great man. Thank you very much. Namaskar. Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir, for yet another insightful, inspiring, and thought-provoking lecture. I now request Vice Admiral Shekhar Sinhaji to present a memento on behalf of India Foundation to our Honorable Vice President, Sri Venkaiah Naidu Garu. Thank you, sir. I now invite Sri Shaurya Dhawal, Member Board of Governors, India Foundation, to kindly deliver the vote of thanks.
Words of thanks, no vote.
All right, sir.
Namaskar. On behalf of the India Foundation, we could not have expected a much more eclectic evening, a much better evening than what we had today. We are actually lucky to have chosen a speaker who we all heard him speak through his heart and bring to life the character of a person who is a guiding light of Indian politics. And I am sure that this lecture tonight will go in posterity for successive generations of workers in public life to give them inspiration, guidance, and actually bring out the real character of Shri Atal Bihari Vajpayee Ji. For this, I would like to, on behalf of the India Foundation, render my word of thanks to the Honorable Vice President of India, Shri Venkaiah Naidu Ji, his secretariat for making it possible for him to be here, all you delegates for attending, our sponsors, the State Administration of Telangana, and finally the Marriott Convention Center. Once again, thank you very much for being with us today evening. Jai Hind.
May I now request all of you to kindly rise for the national anthem.
जनगणमन अधिनायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड उत्तर वंगा विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्चल जलधि तरंगा तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मांगे गाहे तव जय गाथा जनगण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे
With a heavy heart, as the Honorable Vice President just mentioned, I request you all to kindly be placed at your respective places as the Vice President leaves. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.